Chapter 4-4 Self-Esteem. Building a positive self-esteem. An image of beggar was sitting at the train station with a bowl full of pencils. A young executive passed by and dropped a dollar in the bowl. He then boarded the train. Before the doors closed, something came to his mind and he went back to the beggar, grabbed a bunch of pencils, and said, "They are priced right. After all, you are a business person and so am I," and he left. 6 months later, the executive attended a party. The beggar was also there in a suit and tie. The beggar recognized the executive, went up to him and said, "You probably don't recognize me, but I remember you." He then narrated the incident that happened 6 months before. The executive said, "Now that you have reminded me, I do recall that you were begging. What are you doing here in your suit and tie?" The beggar replied, "You probably don't know what you did for me that day. You were the first person in my life who gave me back my dignity. You grabbed the bunch of pencils and said, 'They are priced right. After all, you are a business person and so am one.' After you left, I thought to myself, 'What am I doing here? Why am I begging?' I decided to do something constructive with my life. I packed my bag, started working, and here I am. I just want to thank you for giving me back my dignity." That incident changed my life. What changed in the beggar's life? What changed was that his self-esteem went up and so did his performance. This is the magic of self-esteem in our lives. Simply put, self-esteem is how we feel about ourselves. Our opinion of ourselves critically influences everything, from our performance at work, our relationships, and our role as a parent to our accomplishments in life. Self-esteem is a major component in determining success or failure. High self-esteem leads to a happy, gratifying, and purposeful life. Unless you perceive yourself as worthwhile, you cannot have high self-esteem. All great world leaders and teachers throughout history have concluded that one must be internally driven in order to be a success. We transfer our unconscious self-appraisal to others and they respond to us accordingly. People with high self-esteem grow in conviction, competence, and willingness to accept responsibility. They face life with optimism, have better relationships and fulfilling lives. They are motivated and ambitious. They are more sensitive. Their performance and risk-taking ability go up. They are open to new opportunities and challenges. They can give and receive criticism and compliments, tactfully, and with ease. Self-esteem is a feeling which comes from an awareness of what is good and having done it. Self-esteem is our self-concept. There is a story about a farmer who planted pumpkins on his land. For no reason, he put a small pumpkin, hanging by the vine, into a glass jar. At harvest time, he saw that the pumpkin had grown, equivalent only to the shape and size of the jar. Just as the pumpkin could not grow beyond the boundaries restricting it, human beings cannot perform beyond the boundaries of their self-concept, whatever it may be. Some advantages of high self-esteem. There is a direct relationship between people's feelings and their productivity. High self-esteem is evident in respect for oneself, others, property, law, parents, and one's country. The reverse is also true. Self-esteem builds strong conviction, creates willingness to accept responsibility, builds optimistic attitudes, leads to better relationships and fulfilling lives, makes a person more sensitive to others' needs and develop a caring attitude, makes a person self-motivated and ambitious, makes a person open to new opportunities and challenges, improves performance and increases risk-taking ability, helps a person give and receive both criticism and compliments tactfully and easily. How do we recognize poor self-esteem? What are the behavior patterns of a person with poor self-esteem? The following is a brief list, which is not all-inclusive but is indicative. They are generally gossip mongers. They have a critical nature. They criticize as if there is a contest going on and they have to win a prize. They have high egos. They are arrogant and believe they know it all. People with low self-esteem are generally difficult to work with and for. They tear down others to get a feeling of superiority. They are closed-minded and self-centered. They constantly make excuses, always justifying failures. They never accept responsibility, always blaming others. They have a fatalistic attitude, no initiative, and always waiting for things to happen. They are jealous by nature. They are unwilling to accept positive criticism. They become defensive. They are bored and uncomfortable when alone. Poor self-esteem leads to breakdown in decency. People with low self-esteem don't know where to draw the line where decency stops and vulgarity starts. It is not unusual for people to tell jokes at social get-togethers, but with every drink, the jokes get dirtier and dirtier. They don't have genuine friends because they are not genuine themselves. They make promises they know they are not going to keep. A person with low self-esteem would promise the moon to make a sail. Unkept promises lead to loss of credibility. A person with high self-esteem would prefer loss of business than loss of credibility because they realize that one cannot put a price on one's credibility. Their behavior is senseless and erratic. They swing from one end of the pendulum to another. They may be all sugar and honey today, but the same people may be out to cut your throat tomorrow. They lack balance. They alienate people and tend to be lonely. They are touchy in nature. This is called the fragile ego. Anytime something is said, a person with a fragile ego takes it personally and gets hurt. It leads to dejection. What is the difference between being touchy and being sensitive? Touchiness is the cactus approach. You touch me and I will hurt you. Being sensitive is the positive approach, the caring approach. Many times the two are used interchangeably. People say be careful when talking to so-and-so, he or she is very sensitive. What they are really saying is that the person is touchy, so be careful. They have negative expectations of themselves and others and are seldom disappointed. They lack confidence. 1. They constantly seek approval and validation from others. Seeking approval is different from seeking a second opinion, which really means consultation. 2. Bragging about themselves is also a sign of lack of confidence. 3. Submissive or timid behavior. These are people who constantly apologize for their existence. They are always putting themselves down, which is different from being humble. Humility comes from confidence, whereas putting yourself down comes from lack of it. A person who lacks confidence cannot be an effective leader. Others sense this lack of confidence, which results in a lack of respect. 4. Lack of assertiveness. People with low self-esteem are not willing to stand up for their belief. On the other hand, being unduly aggressive is also a sign of poor self-esteem. Being aggressive in situations that require compassion does not amount to assertiveness. 5. A lack of confidence results in conformist behavior. If everybody is doing it, then so should I. Every day we see people giving in to peer pressure, knowing full well what they are doing could be detrimental, yet they do it to be accepted. People with low self-esteem go along to get along. They are looking for outside validation because they lack confidence in themselves. 6. Keeping up with the Joneses pretense. When people try to keep up with the Joneses, they spend money they haven't earned, they buy things they don't need, and they try to impress people they don't like. 7. Nonconformist or attention-seeking behavior. In order to gain attention, people with poor self-esteem might do senseless things just to stand out and be noticed. They get a kick and a sense of importance from perversion. Some people choose to do wrong and be wrong just to be deferent and gain attention. Examples are people who brag excessively, the classroom clown, etc. They are indecisive and do not accept responsibility. Lack of courage and fear of criticism lead to indecisive behavior. They rebel against authority. I make a distinction between rebelling out of the courage of one's convictions and rebelling because of poor self-esteem. All the great world leaders, such as Mahatma Gandhi, Martin Luther King, and Abraham Lincoln, were rebels. They rebel against authority out of the courage of their convictions. A person with low self-esteem rebels against authority just because it is authority. Even when the authority is right, they are antisocial and may be withdrawn. They lack a sense of direction and have an I don't care
attitude, which is reflected in their behavior. They have a hard time giving or receiving compliments. In giving, they feel they might be misconstrued, and in receiving they feel they are undeserving. Feeling unworthy is not humility. Too much emphasis on material things. People with poor self-esteem judge a person's worth by his possessions, not by who he is. They constantly look at what kind of car you are driving, what kind of home you live in, what kind of clothes and jewelry you wear. They forget that people make things, and not vice versa. People with poor self-esteem place more emphasis on net worth than self-worth. Their lives revolve around ads and fads. Designer labels are their status symbols. Take away their things and they will die of shame. They get into a rat race. The problem with the rat race is that even if you win, you are still a rat. Asterisk. Lack of pride in themselves. They are shabbily dressed and uncouth. They are takers, not givers. Low self-esteem could lead to extremes of behavior. A person with high self-esteem could choose identical behavior for different reasons. He may be alone because he prefers solitude, whereas a person with low self-esteem prefers to be alone because he is uncomfortable in groups. Some characteristics of people with high self-esteem. Low self-esteem. Talk about ideas. Talk about people. Caring attitude. Critical attitude. Humility. Arrogance. Respects authority. Rebels against authority. Courage of conviction. Goes along to get along. Confidence. Confusion. Concerned about character. Concerned about reputation. Assertive. Aggressive. Accepts responsibility. Blames the whole world. Self-interest. Selfish. Optimistic. Fatalistic. Understanding. Greedy. Willing to learn. Know it all. Sensitive. Touchy. Solitude. Lonely. Discuss. Argue. Believes in self-worth. Believes in net worth. Only guided. Misguided. Discipline. Distorted. Sense of freedom. Internally driven. Externally driven. Respects others. Looks down on others. Enjoys decency. Enjoys vulgarity. Knows limit. Everything goes. Giver. Taker. The objective of this list is to provide a basis for self-evaluation rather than produce guilt. It is not necessary to have all the traits. Some characteristics may be present to a greater or lesser degree. So long as we are able to recognize them, we can make an effort to correct ourselves. They put on a mask. A young executive with poor self-esteem was promoted, but he couldn't reconcile himself to his new office and position. There was a knock at his door. To show how important and busy he was, he picked up the phone and then asked the visitor to come in. As the man waited for the executive kept talking on the phone, nodding and saying, "No problem, I can handle that." After a few minutes, he hung up and asked the visitor what he could do for him. The man replied, "Sir, I'm here to connect your phone." What is the message? Why pretend? What are we trying to prove? What do we want to accomplish? Why do we need to lie? Why look for feelings of false importance? All of this comes from insecurity and poor self-esteem. Why pretend? Our character can be judged by everything we do or don't do, like or don't like, such as the kind of movies we enjoy, the kind of music we listen to, the kind of company we keep or avoid, the kind of jokes we tell or laugh at, the kind of books we read. Every action of ours gives us away anyway, so why pretend? I believe that if a person lives with conviction, sensitivity, and cooperation, he can move others with his effort. That person becomes worthy of self-respect. Positive self-esteem. Negative self-esteem. 1. Self-respect. Self-put-down. 2. Self-confidence. Self-doubt. 3. Self-worth. Self-abuse. 4. Self-acceptance. Self-denial. 5. Self-love. Self-centeredness. 6. Self-knowledge. Self-deceit. 7. Self-discipline. Self-indulgence. Self-esteem does not mean having a big ego. Unless a person is at peace with himself, he cannot be at peace with others. Just as we cannot give to others what we don't have. Unless we possess the components of self-esteem, we cannot share it with others. We need to first get in touch with ourselves and put ourselves in order. Even in an aircraft, the safety instructions tell you to put on an oxygen mask on yourself first and then on your child. We are not talking about little eyes upon you. Asterisk, asterisk. There are little eyes upon you and they're watching night and day. There are little ears that quickly take in every word you say. There are little hands all eager to do anything you do, and a little boy who's dreaming of the day he'll be like you. You're the little fellow's idol. You're the wisest of the wise. In his little mind about you, no suspicions ever rise. He believes in you devoutly, holds all that you say and do, he will say and do, in your way, when he's grown up like you. There's a wide-eyed little fellow who believes you're always right, and his eyes are always opened, and he watches day and night. You are setting an example every day in all you do, for the little boy who's waiting to grow up to be like you. Building confidence, a young couple used to leave their daughter at a daycare center every day before going to work. As they parted company, the parents and child kissed each other's hands and then put the kisses in their pockets. All during the day, when the little girl got lonely, she would take out a kiss and put it on her cheek. This little routine made them feel together even though they were physically apart. What a wonderful thought. What makes a child a delinquent? Teach him to put a price tag on everything and he will put his integrity for sale. Teach him never to take a stand and then he will fall for anything. **. From The Moral Compass, edited by William J. Burmett, Simon 8, Tilda Schuster, New York, 1995, pp. 52-24, make him believe that winning is not everything. It is the only thing and he will make every effort to win by hook or by crook. Give a child everything he wants right from infancy and he will grow up believing that the world owes him a living and everything will be handed to him on a platter. When he picks up bad language, laugh at him. This will make him think he is cute. Don't ever give him any moral or ethical values. Wait until he is 21 and let him determine his own. Give him choices without direction. Never teach him that every choice has a consequence. Never tell him he is wrong, he might develop a complex. This will condition him to believe that society is against him when he gets arrested for doing something wrong. Always pick up things that he leaves lying around, books, shoes, clothes, etc. Do everything for him so that he will learn to push all responsibilities onto others. Let him read, watch and hear anything he wants. Be careful what he feeds his body, but let his mind feed on garbage. In order to be popular with his peers, he must go along to get along. Quarrel frequently when he is present. This way he won't be surprised when things fall apart at home. Give him as much money as he wants. Never teach him respect for or the value of money. Make sure he does not have things as tough as you did. Provide instant gratification for all sensual desires such as food, drink, comfort. Deprivation can cause frustration. Side with him against
neighbors, teachers, etc., as they are prejudiced against him. When he gets into real trouble, excuse yourself by saying, "I tried my best but could never do anything with him." Don't put your foot down because you believe discipline takes away freedom. Prefer remote control to parental control in order to teach independence. What children get, they give to society. Children learn what they live. If a child lives with criticism, he learns to condemn. If a child lives with praise, he learns to appreciate. If a child lives with hostility, he learns to knight. If a child lives with tolerance, he learns to be patient. If a child lives with ridicule, he learns to be shy. If a child lives with encouragement, he learns confidence. If a child lives with shame, he learns to feel guilty. If a child lives with approval, he learns to like himself. If a child lives with fairness, he learns justice. If a child lives with security, he learns to have faith. If a child lives with acceptance and friendship, he learns to find love in the world. Education: being ignorant is not shameful, but being unwilling to learn is. Role models can teach through example. Children who are taught the importance of integrity during their formative years generally don't lose it. It becomes a part of life, which is what we are looking for in any profession, whether in a contractor, attorney, accountant, politician's police officer, or judge. Integrity is a lot stronger than honesty. In fact, it is the foundation of honesty. Youths are impressionable. When they see their mentors, such as parents, teachers, or political leaders, cheating with pride or bragging about petty dishonesty, such as stealing a towel in a hotel or cutlery from the restaurants, the following happens: they are disappointed. They lose respect for their mentors. Constant exposure breeds acceptance in them. Poor role models. A schoolteacher asked a little boy what his father did for a living. The boy replied, "I'm not sure, but I guess he makes pens, pencils, light bulbs, toilet rolls, etc., because that is what he brings home every day in his lunchbox." Making unfair comparison. Fair comparisons are okay, but unfair comparisons make a person feel inferior. Comparison basically brings out the competitive spirit to outperform the next person. People with high self-esteem don't compete with others, instead, they improve their own performance. They compete against themselves. They compare their performance against their capabilities. Failure or success, a ripple effect. There is a lot of truth in the statement, success breeds success and failure breeds failure. In sports, we often see that whenever the champion's morale is low and it does get low at some point, the coach will never put him up against a good fighter because if he suffers one more defeat, his self-esteem will go even lower. To bring his self-confidence back, the coach pits him against a weak opponent, and that victory raises
his self-esteem. A slightly stronger opponent is next, and that victory brings up the level of confidence, and on until the day comes when the champion is ready to face the ultimate challenge. With every success, self-confidence goes up and it is easier to succeed the next time. For this reason, any good leader, be it a parent, teacher or supervisor, would start a child off with easy tasks. With every successful completion, the child's level of confidence and self-esteem go up. Add to that positive strokes of encouragement, and this will start solidifying positive self-esteem. Our responsibility is to help break the chain of failure and put ourselves and our children into the chain of success. Confusing failing with failure. When people fail in any particular event, most get so disheartened that they start looking at themselves as failures, not realizing that failing does not equal failure. I might have failed, but I am not a failure. I may be fooled, but I am not a fool. Unrealistic expectations of perfection by parents, teachers and supervisors. Suppose a child comes home with a report card with 5 A's and 1 B. Usually the first thing his parents will say is, "Why the B?" What do you think will go through the child's mind? Did he try for the B? Or should his parents congratulate the child for the B and accept a lower standard? Not at all. What the child is really looking for is acknowledgement and encouragement for the effort in getting the 5 A's. A parent, after acknowledging and praising the A's, can make clear his expectations of seeing all 6 A's and offer help if needed. If we lower our standards, the chances are pretty good that the performance next time would drop to those expectations. Similarly at work, an employee does 100 things right and 1 thing wrong. Guess what the boss picks on? Acknowledge the positive but don't lower your standards. Lack of discipline. What is discipline? Is it absolute freedom to do what a person wants? Is freedom regardless of consequences? Does it mean corrective action after a problem occurs or a wrong is done? Is it imposition? Is it abuse? Does it take away freedom? The answer is none of the above. Discipline does not mean that a person takes a belt and beats up kids. That is madness. Discipline is loving firmness. It is direction. It is prevention before a problem arises. It is harnessing and channeling energy for great performance. Discipline is not something you do to, but you do for those you care about. Discipline is an act of love. Sometimes you have to be unkind to be kind. Not all medicine is sweet, not all surgery is painless, but we have to take it. We need to lean from nature. We are all familiar with that big animal, the giraffe. A mama giraffe gives birth to a baby giraffe, standing. All of a sudden, the baby falls on a hard surface from the cushion of mama's womb, and sits on the ground. The first thing mama does is to get behind the baby and give him a hard kick. The baby gets up, but his legs are weak and wobbly and the baby falls down. Mama goes behind again and gives him one more kick. The baby gets up but sits down again. Mama keeps kicking till the baby gets on its feet and starts moving. Why? Because mama knows that the only chance of survival for the baby in the jungle is to get on its feet. Otherwise it will be eaten up by wildcats and become dead meat. My question to you is this an act of love? You bet it is. Children brought up in a loving, disciplined environment end up respecting their parents more and become law-abiding citizens. The reverse is just as true. If discipline is practiced in every home, juvenile delinquency would be reduced by 95%. J. Edgar Hoover. Good parents are not afraid of momentary dislikes by children to enforce the subject. Discipline gives freedom. Allowing a child to eat a box of chocolate could lead to sickness. At the same time, the discipline of eating 1 or 2 pieces a day can be an enjoyable experience for a longer time. Our instinct makes us do whatever we want regardless of the consequences. Freedom is not procured by a full enjoyment of what is desired, but controlling the desire. Epictetus, there is a misconception that freedom means doing your own thing. One cannot always have what one desires. Many times it is not easy to comprehend the benefits of good values and discipline. It may even seem more profitable, enjoyable, and convenient to do otherwise. All we need to do is see countless instances where lack of discipline has prevented people from succeeding. What we think is pulling us down is really taking us up. That is what discipline is all about. A boy was flying a kite with his father and asked him what kept the kite up. Dad replied, "The string." The boy said, "Dad, it is the string that is holding the kite down." The father asked his son to watch as he broke the string. Guess what happened to the kite? It came down. Isn't that true in life? Sometimes the very things that we think are holding us down are the things that are helping us fly. That is what discipline is all about. I want to be free. We hear this phrase all the time. I want to be free. If you take the train off the track, it is free, but where does it go? If everyone could make their own traffic IAWs and drive on any side of the road, would you call that freedom or chaos? What is missing is discipline. By observing the rule, we are actually gaining freedom, aren't we? It is loving firmness. I have asked this question to many participants in my seminars. If your child had a fever of 105 degf and did not want to go to the doctor, what would you do? Invariably, they said they would get medical help even if the child resisted. Why? Because it is in the best interest of the child. Parenting is not a popularity contest. A judge, when sentencing a man for robbery, asked if he had anything to say. The man replied, "Yes, Your Honor. Please sentence my parents to jail also." The judge asked, "Why?" The prisoner answered, "When I was a little boy, I stole a pencil from school. My parents knew about it but never said a word. Then I stole a pen. They knowingly ignored it. I continued to steal many other things from the school and the neighborhood till it became an obsession. They knew about it, yet they never said a word. If anyone belongs in jail with me, they do. He is right. In not discharging their responsibilities, his parents are also to blame, although it does not absolve him of his responsibility. Giving choices to children is important, but choices without direction result in disaster. Complete mental and physical preparation is the result of sacrifice and self-discipline. Parents spend an average of 15 minutes a week in meaningful dialogue with their children, children who are left to glean whatever values they can from peers and TV. Journal of the American Family Association. Ask yourself, without discipline, can a captain run a ship effectively? Can an athlete win a game? Can a violinist play well at a concert? The answer is, of course not. Why then do we question today, in matters of personal conduct, or to achieve any standard, if discipline is necessary? It is absolutely necessary. Today the philosophy is, if it feels good, do it. I have heard parents innocently saying, "I don't care what my kids do so long as it makes them happy." That is all that matters. I ask them, "Wouldn't you want to know what makes them happy?" If beating people up on the streets and taking their things away are what make them happy, there is a word in the English language for them. It is called perversion. How and where we derive our happiness from is just as important as the happiness itself. It is a result of our values, discipline, and responsibility. We keep hearing, "Do what you like." The reverse is just as true. Like what you do. Many times we need to do what ought to be done, whether we like it or not. A mother comes home after a long day's work, takes care of the household chores, looks after the baby, and goes to sleep exhausted. In the middle of the night, the baby cries. Does mama feel like getting up? No, but she gets up anyway. Why? For three reasons: love, duty, responsibility. We cannot live our lives by emotions alone. We need to add discipline, no matter what age we are. Winning in life comes when we do not succumb to what we want to do but do what ought to be done. That requires discipline. Labeling and put-downs by parents, teachers, and supervisors. Have you heard some parents playfully or affectionately calling their kids dummy and stupid? Labels stick for life. When the kids grow up, they will be sure to prove the parents right. Labels do not only stick for life but for generations. The caste system in India is a prime example of how labeling can hurt. Upper caste or lower caste, if it is not a label, what is it? Common put-downs parents say to their kids are, "You are dumb. You never do anything right, you will never amount to anything." Teaching the right values many times, inadvertently and innocently, we end up teaching wrong values within our families and organizations. For example, we tell our children or staff to lie for us. Tell them I am not here, the check is in the mail. We all look to our parents, teachers and supervisors to teach us integrity. And many times we are disappointed. Practicing these petty lies turns a person into a professional liar. When we teach others to lie for us, a day will come when they will lie to us too. For example, a secretary calls in sick when she really wants to go shopping. Maybe the boss gave her enough practice lying for him that she has become an expert in lying to him. Steps to building a positive self-esteem turn scars into stars. Read the life histories of people who have turned a negative into a positive, adversity into advantage, stumbling blocks into stepping stones. They refuse to let disappointment and failures pull them down. Some of the best music was composed by Beethoven. What was his handicap? He was deaf. Some of the best poetry written on nature was written by Milton. What was his handicap? He was blind. One of the greatest world leaders was U.S. President Franklin D. Roosevelt. What was his handicap? He served from a wheelchair. The Wilma Rudolph story *Wilma Rudolph was born into a poor home in Tennessee. At age 4, she had double pneumonia with scarlet fever, a deadly combination which left her paralyzed with polio. She had to wear a brace and the doctor said she would never put her foot on the earth. But her mother encouraged her. She told Wilma that with God-given ability, persistence and faith she could do anything she wanted. Wilma said, "I want to be the fastest woman on the track on this earth." At the age of 9, against the advice of the doctors, she removed the brace and took the first step the doctors had said she never would. At the age of 13, she entered her first race and came way last. And then she entered her second, and third and fourth and came way last until a day came when she came in first. At the age of 15 she went to Tennessee State University where she met a coach by the name of Ed Temple. She told him, "I want to be the fastest woman on the track on this earth." Temple said, "With your spirit nobody can stop you and besides, I will help you." The day came when she was at the Olympics and at the Olympics you are matched with the best of the best. Wilma was matched against a woman named Yuta Haina who had never been beaten. The first event was the 100-meter race. Wilma beat Yuta Haina and won her first gold medal. The second event was the 200-meter race and Wilma beat Yuta a second time and won her second gold medal. The third event was the 400-meter relay and she was racing against Yuta one more time. In the relay, the fastest person always runs the last lap and they both anchored their teams. The first three people ran and changed the baton. Easily. When it came to Wilma's turn, she dropped the baton. But Wilma saw Yuta shoot up at the other end. She picked the baton, ran like a machine, beat Yuta a third time and won her third gold medal. It became history that a paralytic woman became the fastest woman on this earth at the 1960 Olympics. Adapted from Star Ledger, November 13, 1994. What a lesson to be learned from Wilma. It teaches us that successful people do it in spite of, not in absence of, problems. When we hear or read stories of people who have turned adversity into opportunity, doesn't it motivate us? If we regularly read biographies and autobiographies of such people, won't we stay motivated? Learn intelligent ignorance. Education teaches us what we can do and also teaches us what we cannot do. I'm looking for a lot of men with an infinite capacity for not knowing what cannot be done. Henry Ford gave this world the V8 engine. He did not have much formal education. In fact, he did not go to school beyond the age of 14. He was intelligent enough to know there had to be a V8 engine, but he was ignorant and didn't know how to build it. So he asked all his highly qualified, educated people to build one. But they told him what could be done and what couldn't. According to them, a V8 was an impossibility. But Henry Ford insisted on having his V8. A few months later, he asked his people if they had the V8 and they replied, "We know what can be done and we also know what cannot be done, and V8 is an impossibility." This went on for many months and still Henry Ford said, "I want my V8. And shortly thereafter the same people produced his V8 engine. How come? They let their imagination run beyond academic limitation. Education teaches us what can be done and sometimes also teaches us false limitations. The bumblebee we need to learn from nature. According to scientists, the bumblebee's body is too heavy and its wingspan too small. Aerodynamically, the bumblebee cannot fly. But the bumblebee doesn't know that and it keeps flying. When you don't know your limitations, you go out and surprise yourself. In hindsight, you wonder if you had any limitations. The only limitations a person has are those that are self-imposed. Don't let education put limitations on you. Do something for others who cannot repay you in cash or kind." Dr. Carl Menninger, a world-renowned psychiatrist, was once asked, "What would you advise someone if you knew that person was going to have a nervous breakdown?" The audience expected Dr. Menninger to advise consulting a professional. But he didn't. He said, "I would advise that person to lock home, go to the other side of town, find someone in need and help that person. By doing that we get out of our own way. A lot of times we get in our own way, don't we? Be a volunteer. It builds self-worth. Helping others as you would expect others to help you gives a feeling of gratification. It is a good feeling which represents high self-esteem. The process of giving without having expectations or getting anything in return raises one's self-esteem. A healthy personality has the need not only to get but also to give. Learn to give and receive compliments. Don't miss out on any opportunity to give sincere compliments. Remember, the key word is sincerity. When others give you a compliment, accept it graciously and gracefully with two words, thank you. That is a sign of humility. Accept responsibility. We need to accept responsibility for our behavior and our actions and insulate ourselves from excuses. Don't be like the student who failed just because he didn't like the teacher or the subject. Who is he hurting the most? We have to accept responsibility and stop blaming others. Then, and only then, will productivity and quality of life improve. Our privileges can be no greater than our obligations. The protection of our rights can endure no longer than the performance of our responsibilities. John F. Kennedy: excuses make the problem worse than the problem itself. We owe responsibility to self, to family, to work, to society, environment. We can add to the greenery by planting trees, stopping soil erosion, preserving natural beauty. We cannot live as if we have another earth we can move to. On a daily basis, we need to do something that makes this world a better place to live. We are custodians for the future generations. If we do not behave responsibly, how can future generations forgive us? If the average life expectancy of a person is 75 years and if you are 40 years old, you have 365 days by 35 years to live. Ask yourself this question: what are you going to do with this time? When we accept or add responsibility, we make ourselves more valuable. Don't we? Self-discipline does not kill joy but builds it. You see people with talent and ability, and yet they are unsuccessful. They are frustrated and the same behavior pattern affects their business, their health, and their relationships with others. They are dissatisfied and blame it on luck without realizing that many problems are caused by lack of discipline. Set goals. Well-defined goals give a person a sense of direction, a feeling of accomplishment when he reaches his goals. More important than goals is a sense of purpose and vision. It gives meaning and fulfillment to life. What we get upon achieving our goals is a lot less important than what we become. It is the becoming which gives us a good feeling. That is what self-esteem is all about. In goal setting, we need to be realistic. Unrealistic goals remain unaccomplished, leading to poor self-esteem, whereas realistic goals are encouraging and build high self-esteem. Associate with people of high moral character. Associate yourself with people of good quality if you esteem your reputation, for it is better to be alone than to be in bad company. George Washington test of friendship. Negative influences come in the form of peer pressure. People say, "Aren't you my friend?" Remember, true. Friends never want to see their friends hurt. If I ever saw that a friend had had one drink too many, I would put my foot down and not let him drive. I would rather lose the friendship than lose a friend. It is common to see people doing wrong things to get accepted, saying, "It is cool," not realizing they will be left cold. What starts as peer pressure may be in reality a test of friendship. Where will they be when you are in trouble? How far will they go to help you? And the biggest question is, if they don't have the character today, how will they have the character tomorrow to help you? Associating with people of high moral character helps build self-esteem. Peer pressure, when the desire to belong to the herd becomes stronger than the desire to stand up for what is right, it is evident that what is lacking is courage and character. It is less controversial. Going along to get along is a safer way, keeps one's peers happy, and one does not risk being laughed at. That is where people with high self-esteem draw the line. That is what separates the men from the boys. Examples: school kids conform because they do not want to be laughed at, they don't give the answers because others will make fun of them. Factory workers keep performance low to keep peers happy. Moderation. Many people say, "In moderation, it is okay. I try a little and quit." The question is, in moderation, is it really okay? To cheat, to steal, to take drugs, to lie, to have illicit affairs. Some people frequently rationalize, "I can quit whenever I want." They don't realize that negative influences are more powerful than willpower. Become internally driven, not externally driven. One day, if someone gets up on the right side of the bed and calls me and says, "You are the greatest person on earth. You are doing a great job, and I want you to know I am honored to call you a friend," I know he is sincere. How does it make me feel? Great. But the next day, he gets up on the wrong side of the bed, picks up the phone and says, "You rascal, you cheat, you crook. You are the biggest fraud in town." How does it make me feel? Terrible. So the first day when he says, "You are the greatest guy," I feel great, and the next day when he says, "You rascal," I feel terrible. Who is controlling my life? Obviously, he is. Is that the way I want to go through life? Not at all. That is being externally driven. I want to be internally driven. When he calls me and says I am the greatest guy, it is good to hear those words. But even if he doesn't say those words, in my own estimation, I am still a good human being. And the next day when he rips me apart, he can't really, because in my own estimation, I am still a good human being. When people make statements like, "You make me angry," the focus of control is external. But if I say I am angry or I choose to be angry, the focus of control is internal. No one can make you feel inferior without your permission. Eleanor Roosevelt. There is a story about an ancient Indian sage who was called ugly names by a passerby. The sage listened unperturbed till the man ran out of words. He asked the man, "If an offering is not accepted, who does it belong to?" The man replied, "It belongs to the person who offered it." The sage said, "I refuse to accept your offering," and walked away, leaving the man dazed. The sage was internally driven. So long as we blame outside sources, our miseries will continue and we will feel helpless. Unless we accept responsibility for our feelings and behavior, we cannot change. The first step is to ask, "Why did I get upset? Why am I angry? Why am I depressed?" Then we start getting the clues to overcome them. Happiness is a result of positive self-esteem. If you ask people what makes them happy, you will get all kinds of answers. Most of them would include material things, but that is not really true. Happiness comes from being and not having. One can have everything in life and yet not be happy. The reverse is also true. Happiness is internal. Happiness is like a butterfly. You run after it, it keeps flying away. If you stand still, it comes and sits on your shoulder. Develop a mindset that brings happiness. Bitterness is a sign of emotional failure. It paralyzes our capacity to do good. Set your own standards. Be honest to yourself. Compete against yourself. Do the following: look for the positive in every person and in every situation. Resolve to be happy. Set your own standards judiciously. Develop an immunity to negative criticism. Learn to find pleasure in every little thing. Remember, all times are not the same. Ups and downs are part of life. Make the best of every situation. Keep yourself constructively occupied. Help others less fortunate than yourself. Learn to get over things. Don't brood. Forgive yourself and others. Don't hold guilt or bear grudges. Give yourself positive auto-suggestions. Develop the habit of giving yourself positive self-talk. Auto-suggestions alter our belief system by influencing the subconscious mind. Our behavior reflects our belief system. Hence, auto-suggestions affect our behavior by influencing our belief system. It becomes a self-fulfilling prophecy. Examples: I can handle it. I can do it. I am good at math. I have a good memory. Our greatest strength can become our greatest weakness. Any strength overextended becomes a weakness. For example, in sales, good speaking ability is a strength. It is not uncommon to see salespeople with good speaking ability talk themselves into a sale, then talk too much and talk themselves right out of the sale. Their strength got them into it, however, overextended, it became a weakness and they lost the sale. Listening is a strength. Overextended, however, it could mean that a person listens a lot but does not speak enough. It becomes a weakness. Our greatest weakness can become our greatest strength. Anger as a weakness. How can it be turned into a strength? One lady demonstrated by getting mad. MAD stands for Mothers Against Drunk Driving. This lady lost her child because of a drunk driver. She got so angry that she resolved not to tolerate this kind of thing in society. She organized people all over the United States to fight drunk driving. Today, she and her association have become a significant force, with thousands of members, and are succeeding in their pursuit to change legislation in Congress. That is turning a negative emotion, like anger, into a strength by doing.